In 1816, ash clouds from Indonesia's Mount Tambora caused the year without a summer, sending much of the northern hemisphere into a volcanic winter during normally pleasant months. Trapped inside and really, really bored, 18-year-old Mary Shelley accepted a challenge from Percy Shelley and Lord Byron to write a ghost story. The tale that sprung to life from her hand would become known as the first work of science fiction. Today we're going to explore the monster mash that is Mary Shelley's scientific influences, the nuts and bolts of medicine during her time, and some shocking real-life experiments that her story inspired. It'll have you in stitches. I'm sorry. There is a real Castle Frankenstein in Germany, and it was once inhabited by a doctor and alchemist named Johann Dippel, who legend claims conducted experiments on immortality using stolen cadavers. But although she later traveled in the region, there's little evidence that Mary Shelley used Dr. Johann as a model for Victor Frankenstein. The most likely origin for Mary Shelley's story is a prison in London. The science of medical dissection was still in its infancy during Mary's day, mostly due to a shortage of bodies, pretty much the opposite of the brain scoop.
I didn't even think about that!
Most people viewed dissection as an immoral act, so much so, in fact, that the Murder Act of 1752 added it to the punishment of convicted killers, because I guess being hung at the gallows just wasn't bad enough. In 1803, the body of one George Foster was delivered intact to the Royal College of Surgeons under control of an Italian physicist, Giovanni Aldini. Aldini was the nephew of Luigi Galvani, who was one of the first scientists to study a phenomenon then known as animal electricity. He noted that the legs of dead frogs would twitch when they were shocked, and hypothesized that life itself was mediated by an electrical fluid within our bodies. Inspired by his uncle's work, Aldini was a showman who would frequently perform demonstrations of animal electricity using dead creatures, but he wasn't satisfied with cows' heads and little froggy legs. Little did George Foster know, he was the lucky guy chosen by Aldini to demonstrate his ultimate theory, that given a large enough shock, an intact human corpse could be brought back to life.
Oh, it's alive! It's alive! It's alive! It's alive!
Of course, when Aldini stood over the body and flipped the switch, Foster seized and shook and convulsed, and electricity coursed through his corpse, and he was still dead. But according to legend, in the audience that day was a medic named Anthony Carlyle. Carlyle frequently attended these smarty pants cocktail parties, the home of one William Godwin, who happened to be Mary Shelley's father. Now, we have no way of knowing this for sure, but the story of George Foster, Aldini, and galvanism may have been planted in the imagination of an eavesdropping young girl in 1803. In fact, the Dr. Darwin mentioned in the preface to Frankenstein is not Charles, but his grandfather Erasmus, an English practitioner of galvanism. Mary's husband Percy Shelley had himself collected equipment for and experimented with animal electricity. Galvanism was the vacuum-brewed coffee in Wes Anderson movies of its time. If you're cool, you're into it. Over the next 150 years, Frankenstein fascination grew and was ultimately reimagined in legendary film adaptations. Not that one, this one. In the early 1900s, Soviet scientist Sergei Brukhonenko spent decades devising a means to keep dismembered body parts alive and revive the dead. I'm not going to show you any more of that film because it's really gruesome stuff, but there's a link in the description if you want to check out more. But you have been warned. Ooh. In many ways, our obsession with Frankensteinian science continues today, from experiments in cryopreservation, life extension, and even the successful creation of synthetic life. But beyond just pointing to people and experiments that remind us of the book, we should ask what Frankenstein really teaches us about life and science. Frankenstein and the stories it's influenced are often used as warnings that when science and technology reach beyond what's appropriate, it can only lead to very bad things like man-eating blobs, killer tomatoes, Jeff Goldblum turning into a fly.
Gee, the lack of humility before nature that's being displayed here staggers me.
In his 1994 essay, The Monster's Human Nature, Stephen Jay Gould argues that Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, the book and not the movie adaptations, is not a cautionary tale about offenses against a divine or natural order, or going beyond what nature intended, because nature doesn't intend to do anything. Mary Shelley's monster is not the caveman of the movies. He is well-read, intelligent, curious, but also like 8 feet tall and really, really ugly. This creature's born innocent, but with the potential to do monstrous things. That means he's kind of like all of us, an amalgamation of nature and nurture.
From what was once an inarticulate mass of lifeless tissues, may I now present a cultured, sophisticated, man about town.
Dr. Frankenstein's moral failing is not against nature itself, but it's in failing to nurture a feeling being and thereby exposing the darkest parts of its potential. The monster becomes a monster because people sometimes act monstrously. That doesn't mean science is good or bad, because science isn't either of those things. We are. I want to know what you think. What warnings or cautionary tales do you see in Mary Shelley's Frankenstein? Do any of the film or other adaptations get it right? Let me know down in the comments. And while you're at it, you should head over to PBS Digital Studios' YouTube channel and check out the amazing Frankenstein MD, a modern retelling of the modern Prometheus from the folks who brought you the Lizzie Bennett Diaries. It is awesome. Stay curious. Blood-sucking mosquito species have very discerning palates when it comes to which species they feed on. Mosquitoes that prefer birds, for instance, may not suck our blood. Only a few hundred species are actually known to poke those tiny holes in humans.